Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to present my dissertation, Human Detection Tracking and Segmentation in Surveillance Video. Video surveillance is very important for public security. Every year, trillions of hours of video are captured by cameras. However, it is very expensive for humans to process these videos. So we can use computer vision for this task, for it is automatic and it can run 24 hours, 7 days, non-stop. So computer vision can do a few video surveillance tasks. For example, human detection, human tracking, human segmentation, action recognition, behavior recognition, and abnormal behavior detection. This dissertation, we focus on human detection, tracking, and segmentation. There are four pieces of my dissertation. The first one is human detection using superpixel segmentation, which is published in CVPR 2013. So there are two problems of the current human detectors. First, the training data set doesn't contain all human instances. For example, this figure shows the injured person data set where the humans are all in standing positions. If we train a human detector using this data set and test on those images where the humans have unusual poses like jumping, running, the detector may probably fail. The second problem is that hawk features see a different visual world, and most detectors use hawk features. One week has shown some images of the hawk feature visualization. We can see they look like humans, but the original image are not humans. So this means the hawk feature are not always reliable. So according to these two problems, we proposed our method. We use unsupervised learning framework to collect new examples, train a new classifier, and improve the detections. The first step is to get initial detection. We employ DPM human detector by physics wall. This is the DPM model. It consists of a few of parts. If we scan the image using this model, we can get a response by this equation. So the first term is correlation between the image and the parts. Second term is deformation cost of these parts. If we apply the DPM model on this video frame, we can get many detections. We can group the detections into three groups. If the response is larger than threshold TP, it is a positive example. If the response is smaller than threshold TN, it is a negative example. If the response is between TP and TN, it is a hard example. So hard means it is very difficult for DPM to determine the label. So our method is to train a new classifier and use it to label hard examples. Let's look at the training. So given the positives and negatives, we will train a linear SVM classifier, which is the linear support vector machine. So we will get SM weights by minimizing this function. The first term is regularization term. Second term is loss function of the feature X and label Y. After we got SVM, we can use to classify the hard examples and get persons and non-persons. So the SVM score is computed using this equation. However, it is very difficult to get good results by just training once. So we propose iterative learning strategy that we select the confident examples from the classification results and put them back to the training data and train a second classifier. So it is formulated by this equation. Here we use AI. AI is a binary variable that controls which example is used to for the training. So if the SM score FXI is confident, we will use example I in the training data set. So to train the SVM classifier, we also need good features. The hawk features are not reliable. So we propose these superpixel features, which contains color information. So given the detection window, we get superpixel segmentation. Each superpixel is represented by this five-dimensional feature vector, f equal xy lab. Xy is average location, lab is the average color features. Why use superpixels? Because the non-rigid shape can represent the non-rigid objects like humans. And superpixel can preserve local color information. And superpixels are computational efficient than using the pixels. So now we have the superpixels. We need to find a way to convert them to a feature vector. So we choose a bag of words approach. We extract all superpixels from all the detections and put them in this five-dimensional feature space. We use a k-means clustering to get many clusters. We get thousands of clusters. Each cluster is represented by an average superpixel. We call them dictionary. We can use dictionary to convert the detection into a histogram. So in this histogram, each bin is the x-axis is the index of the dictionary. So y-axis is the number of superpixels. Here we show more examples of the detections and superpixels, and we can quantize them into the histograms. These histograms will be normalized and used as feature vectors for SM training and classification. Okay, let's see the experiments. We tested our method on six video sequences. This is the parking lot one video. The green bound box shows the results by DPM detector. We can see there are two missed detections and one false detection. This figure shows the results by our method. We have fixed all the problems. This is the parking lot 2 video sequence. There are three missed detections. And this is our method. We fixed all the problems. This is the past 2009 video sequence. You can see there's one missed detection. And our method can detect this person. This is the town center data set. There are three missed detections. And our method can detect them. So let's look at the skateboarding video data set. We draw the results on the same frame. So we can see for these frames, the DPM detector fails to detect this person. But our method works very well. Here I'm going to show the quantitative results. This is the precision recall curve. X-axis is the recall, y-axis is the precision. The blue dot line shows the original DPM detector. The red dot line is our method. The green dot line is our method without using the superpixel features. We use Hawk feature instead. We can see the our method is better than the original DPM detector, and our method with superpixel feature is better than using Hawk feature. And we tested on all the six video sequences, and we get the same conclusion. This table shows average precision on all the six video sequences. We can see our method has improved DPM detector by up to 16% in average precision. Table 2 shows another metric, which is the precision recall break-even point. And we have the same conclusion. So to summarize this chapter, we proposed a human detection approach using unsupervised learning. We proposed a superpixel-based bag of word representation. We have improved the DPM detector by up to 16%. Now, given the detections, we can track humans by associating the detections. So I'm going to talk about the second piece of my work, multi-person tracking with occlusion handling, which is published in CVPR 2012. This video shows the objective of the tracking task. Each person is labeled in a different color. So we need to track multiple persons, maintain their identities, and handle the occlusions. Let's see the proposed method. Given the video input, first we will do human detection. we choose to use DPM detector. This video shows the detection results. We can see the parts are moving according to the person's ego motion. So inspired by this, we propose to use the part-based model in tracking. This figure shows the two views of the same person in a video. We can see all the parts are strictly correspondent. Like number 2 is always the head. Number 3 and number 9 are always the feet. So it is a good choice to use the part-based model for tracking because first, it represents the non-rigid objects like humans. Second, it contains less background noise. Third, it is more efficient to compute than using the whole bounding box. The next step is feature extraction. Given the detection result, we can put all the parts together and we extract features such as color histogram and local binary pattern. With this feature, we can train a person-specific SVM classifier. So the positive examples are from the same person in all previous frames. The negative examples are from all other persons. This SVM classifier is updated for every couple of frames. So it is online learning. And we will use this classifier for the data association. So the data association is to find the best match between two frames, T and T plus 1. We calculate the similarity matrix using three terms. The first term is classification score. Cij is the classification score of the example J using the classifier I. Z is the distance term, which measures the distance between two detections I and J. E is the size term, which measures the size difference between the two detections I and J. So after data association, we can get the output. Let's go back to the framework. After human detection, we do feature extraction, person classification, and data association, and we get tracks as output. To handle the occlusion, we propose the occlusion handling method in the detection stage. So let's see this. We know that DPM detection score is computed using this equation, which sums up all the part scores. If the person is partially occluded, the overall score will be lower than threshold, so it will not be detected. So our method is to find the best subset of the parts by this equation, where SM is a subset of all parts. A and B are parameters of this sigmoid fitting function. So using this function, we can search over the combinations of all parts and find the best subset that has the highest average score. So even the person is partially occluded, we can still detect the subset of the parts. Let's see some occlusion handling results. This is the result by the original DPM detector. We can see it has many missed detections. And this figure shows our method. We can detect more people by detecting the upper body, which is shown in the green, and the head, which is shown in the yellow. Here is one more example. This is the original DPM detector. And this is our method. So we can detect much more people. In addition to this occlusion handling detection, we also proposed occlusion handling in the tracking stage. So during the tracking, sometimes we want to know which part are exactly occluded. So we can estimate SM score XI for each individual part. This is SM score. We can break down the FX so that we get the part score FXI. We draw the scores on the, in the figure. If the score is negative, we will label it as occluded, as shown in the red. So the purpose of doing this is that we can retrain the person classifier using only the non-occluded parts, so we can avoid using the occluded parts that will hurt the SVM model. Okay, let's see some occlusion reasoning results. This is the original image, and this is our reasoning result. We can see the red parts shows the occlusions. Here is another example. We can see our method can accurately reason the occlusions. Let's see the experiments. So this video shows the tracking results on the town center video sequence. We show a few clips of this video. We can see each person is labeled in a different color. This video sequence do not have heavy occlusions. Okay, let's see the quantitative results of town center sequence. We measured our method using clear mode metric, where MOTA is the tracking accuracy. It measures the false positive, false negative, and ID switches. MOTP is the tracking precision. It measures the overlap rate between the tracker and the person. MODA and MODP measures the detection performance. So the most important metric is MOTA. We compared our method with a few previous works. We can see the previous works got almost 65% accuracy. Well, our method gets 72%. We compare three versions of our method. Ours one is occlusion handling in tracking stage. Ours two is occlusion handling in detection. Ours three has both. We can see they got very close scores because this video sequence do not have heavy occlusions. The second video shows the tracking results on the Boston Airport video sequence. This is a very challenged video sequence. There are a lot of persons and many occlusions. Let's see the quantitative results. For the MOTA, we can see that our method 2 got 49% accuracy, which is much better than ours one. This means that the occlusion handling detection is much more important for the crowded environments. This video shows the tracking results on parking lot one video sequence. There are a couple of persons walking in line. There are no heavy occlusions. So the three of our method get very close scores. Here we show a few more videos of the parking lot data set. So our method can works very well on most of the videos, but we also show a failed example in the bottom right video. In the bottom right video, we can see there are two persons walking very close, but the tracker keeps switching between the two persons. The reason is that the detector cannot separate the two persons, so the tracker got confused. Okay, to summarize this chapter, this is the first work to leverage the DPM in tracking. We propose the online learn person-specific classifier for multiple person tracking. And we propose two occlusion handling methods for detection and tracking. In addition to tracking, we can also use detection to initialize the segmentation. So this is the third piece of my work, multiple human segmentation by detection. So given the video frames, the first step is to do human detection. We use the proposed human detection method to get human detections and many background examples. So next step is to do detection at the superpixel level. So the detection usually requires a background probability and the foreground probability. To get the background probability, we build a background Gaussian mixture model. Given the background examples, we extract all the superpixels and we can build background GMM on the color feature space. Now given the detection window, we get superpixels and we compare each superpixel with the background GMM, and we can get the probability for each superpixel. And this figure shows all the probabilities. We can see the red color shows the high value, the blue color shows the low value. So high value means it is more likely to be the background. We can see the human body area have low confidence to be the background. The next step is to get the foreground probability using part-based detection potential. So we can use DPM to get 8 parts for each person. And instead of using the parts, we use the part filter responses from all the 8 parts. We can see these response maps can describe the human body distribution. So combined with the root filter response, we can get a detection potential, which will be used as a foreground probability. Now, given the background probability PB and detection potential PD, we can get a binary segmentation using graph optimization. The problem can be formulated as a binary labeling problem in the graph. So each node in the graph represents a superpixel in the image. And we want to label the node I as foreground or background. So we can solve this graph by minimizing this energy function. The first term D is unit term, which is obtained by the background probability and the foreground probability. The second term is pairwise term, which is used to smooth the segmentation. So there are two graph models to compute the pairwise term. The first is Markov random field, which considers the label difference Fi minus Fj. A second model called conditional random field, which additionally consider the color difference between two superpixels. So CRF use more information and you'll get better results. So we use CRF in our method. And this inner function is solved using graph cut implementation by Boykov. Let's see some initial results. Given the detection windows, we can get background confidence maps and detection potentials. And we use CRF to get initial detections. However, there are some noise in these detections. So we need a second stage segmentation at the pixel level, which we also leverage multi-frame information. So first, we get a few detections for the same person adjacent frames. And then we get initial foreground segments, and we build a foreground Gaussian mixture model. So we can get the foreground confidence maps for these detections. And we do the same way to the background and get background GMM and get background confidence maps UB. And we use a multi-frame CRF to get segmentations. How do we get the tracklets? So we use a straightforward method that groups all detections into tracklets by their similarities. The similarity is computed using the color histogram similarity and the overlap rate. So the final step is to do multi-frame CRF. We extend the graph to a 3D graph where each layer is a video frame and each node is a pixel. So the 3D graph allows us to use the spatio-temporal constraints, which can prove the segmentation. We use the same energy function with a few differences. So now we use other pixels instead of superpixels. And for the pairwise term, we consider the 3D constraints instead of the 2D constraints. The unary term D is obtained from the foreground probability UF and the background probability UB. The pairwise term V is obtained using the difference between two pixels. Let's see the experiments. So we test our method using 6 video sequences. We manually label the ground truth for all the video. So we manually segment out humans for every 10 frames in for each video. And let's see the comparison with background subtraction. This is original video frames. The second column shows the results using background subtraction. We can see there are a lot of noise. And the third column shows the results by our method. It is more accurate and cleaner. Next, I'm going to show the segmentation results by individual individual persons. Given the human detections, we get the initial segments. They are not good. So the third column shows, the third row shows the our detection results without using the multi-frame optimization. So there are many noise in the boundary. And this figure shows our final results. We can see the boundary are smoothed and very accurate. So the segmentation has improved by using more steps. We also compare our method with the popular grub cut segmentation method. We can see our method is much better than grub cut. Okay, here I'm showing the segmentation results by frame. This is a parking lot 1 video and parking lot 2. We show all the segmentations in the red color. And this is the PATS 2009 video and town center video sequence. So our method can get a very clean and accurate segmentation. Let's see quantitative results. This table measures the identity-based segmentation accuracy, which is the average accuracy over all the detection windows. We can see our method got the best result of all these previous methods. And table 2 shows frame-based segmentation error, which is the segmentation error of all the frames. The lower numbers are better. We can see our method is still the best. This figure shows the average accuracy over all sequences. So our method is shown in the green. We can see it is the best of all. We also studied how the accuracy changes as a function of the number of Gaussians. We can see the accuracy increases with more number of Gaussians, and it is converged at about the number 20. This figure shows how the accuracy changes as a function of the tracklet length. The accuracy increases with a longer tracklet length, and it is converged at length 15. This figure shows how the accuracy changes as a function of number of superpixels. So it is converged at about 100 superpixels. To summarize this chapter, we propose a multiple human segmentation based on human detection. We leverage DPM detection potential to capture the spatial distribution. And we use multi-frame optimization to smooth the boundaries. Okay, for real-world application, the primary consideration is computational cost. So we desire a computer vision system that is fast, simple, and easy to use. So here we propose the third, the last piece of my work, NUNA system for real-time tracking. NUNA system is part of WAS project executed by HSA RPA. This figure shows the Boston Logan Airport terminal, and where they install a high-resolution sensor. So the current sensor has 8 high-resolution cameras. It provides 100 megapixel, 360 degree field of view. They are developing a next-generation sensor, which has 48 cameras and even smaller size. This video are captured by the current sensor. So the objective of NUNA is to track persons in these high-resolution videos at different viewpoints. Okay, this Here I show the demo of Nona system. The user can load a video from storage and manually label a person to start tracking. The red button box shows the tracker, and the user can stop the video at any time and switch to another target, and it will automatically start to track it. And the user can switch to any targets in real time. So to achieve the real time speed, we used the multi-threaded implementation. So we initialized three threads, one thread for video ingestion, one thread for video output. The three threads are communicated by a frame queue and a track queue. I see the overview of the tracking algorithm. Given the video frames, we can predict a region based on the linear motion model. And we do normalized cross-correlation between the region and the template. So we can get exactly location of the person, and we will update the template for every frame. Since it's a very easy method, it is fast, but there are few problems. First, there are skill change. So if a person is walking towards camera, the tracker cannot follow the size change. Second is drifting. If a person is temporarily occluded by something, the tracker will drift into the background and stop there. So to address the first problem, we use adaptive scaling technique. We use a set of templates with different sizes, and we try to find the best skill by maximizing the correlation score M for each time. So you can choose the best skill for each frame, and here shows the results using adaptive scaling. Now the tracker can follow the size change of the person. The second technique is local frame differencing, which we can get the local difference between the two adjacent frames. So this image shows the motion. We can use the motion image as a mask on the correlation results. If the person is occluded, the motion image is all zeros. So we know that there's no good match, and the tracker will move as predicted location. When the person shows again, there's motion again, so the tracker can get the person. Let's see the experiments. Here we tracked each individual person on this data set, and we show all the results in the same frame. We can see there are about 50 persons, and we can track almost all of them. This is another video sequence. There are some skill changes, and we can also handle that. Here I'm going to show the quantitative results. We compared the accuracy using the high resolutions and the low resolution. We can see the high resolution is 10% better than using the low resolution. So accuracy is defined by the percentage of person we can track. Here is the running time. We can see the frame ingestion and video output takes even more time than tracking itself. So that's the reason we use multi-threading. The multi-threading almost doubles the speed of single threading. So it is 9 frames per second, which means for each frame, it takes 0.11 second. So we can almost do a real-time tracking for 10 frames per second video. To summarize this chapter, we developed a computer vision system for real-time tracking in high-resolution videos. And we use multi-threaded architecture with OpenCV and Intel TBB. And we use a correlation-based tracker using adaptive scaling and local frame difference techniques. To conclude this dissertation, first, we proposed human detection method which use unsupervised learning framework and superpixel-based features. Second, we proposed the human tracking method, use part-based model, online learning classifiers, and two occlusion handling methods. Third, we proposed the human segmentation method using the detection potential and multi-frame optimization. Last, we introduced a NONA system that can do real-time tracking, and it is implemented by multi-threaded architecture, and we use adaptive scaling and local frame differencing. There are some future work we can explore. First is motion-based human detection. So most detectors use static features. However, we can leverage motion features in the video. For example, we can use histogram of optic flow features. That would help the detection. The second is we can track humans across multiple cameras. So now we have this data set with different viewpoints. We can track person walking from one scene to another scene. A possible solution is to use Markov chain model to model the state change between the scenes. For example, if a person exits from one scene, we can use a Markov chain model to obtain the probabilities he enters other scenes. Combined with the appearance features, we should be able to track the person. Okay, here shows some of my publications. That's all. Thank you.